This is a dilemma suffered by children and their parents routinely. The child wants to play, run around, wrestle in mud, catch a ball, aim and shoot stones, hang out with friends. The parent wants to prepare them for the real world, a complex world. They want them to study, which to most children is the most boring thing they can do with their time. Why does this conflict, this disparity exist? Who's right? To take a shot at this question, I've invited my friend and collaborator, the ace game designer Zain Memon, for today's conversation. Games, a natural learning system. Zain, let's dive into this. Why games?
So, you see, the young of every species plays. Sports, games, free-flowing, competitive, cooperative, all kinds of games. Cubs, kittens, puppies, they all play games. Even spiders play games. But why? Why does everyone play games and why are they so much fun? You see, the natural world is replete with high stakes. One misstep could mean losing out on the hunt or worse, being hunted. Playing simulates these high stakes in a safe environment. Kittens play hunt with lizards or with strings even to simulate hunting for survival. The risk is reduced so that they can prepare for the real world out there. Human children also play, and the games of humans are not very unlike the games of other children of other species. Like cubs and puppies, we grow up playing hide and seek, we play tag, we wrestle in the mud, we race around in the pool. These games train us for the real world out there.
So I can imagine the value of tag and hide and seek in learning, hunting and gathering. But I'm hard pressed to imagine how these games can train humans for the real world.
Exactly, they won't, perhaps very little. Our world today is vastly different from the world that our genetic software evolved in, and which was hundreds of thousands of years ago. We no longer need to prepare for the hunt or watch our backs for predators. The words hunt, predators, or even watching our backs are now mostly metaphors for far more invisible challenges and threats. We hunt for jobs that will eventually give us food and sustenance in lieu of our labor. And this job and this hunting is done through years and years of training.
Right. And for a large number of humans today, predators are less likely to kill us and more likely to steal our rights and hence our abilities and opportunities.
Exactly. That's right. And our dearest loved ones, a matter of fact, might end up unwittingly predating on our futures by electing, let's say, bad policies into place.
So where does this gap arise from?
Well, the effort and reward between learning and food is so far removed in the modern world that the connection becomes practically invisible to most of us. While in school, the classes on mathematics and trigonometry don't really seem useful to most of us. It takes decades for the skill to be perfected and practiced and applied by an engineer to build a bridge. Then it takes hundreds of other expertises and specializations like, you know, urban planning, material sciences, ecological conservation, and policy to actually build a single bridge. The engineers and the other experts have to work in a complex dynamic that needs them to optimize time, resources, needs them to negotiate with each other, with local communities. They need to plan for contingencies and failures to eventually culminate into building a single bridge. Now, building this bridge allows the engineer to draw a salary, which is then traded with another complex ecosystem of food production. Now, this path between learning and eating has hundreds of thousands of steps between it, which is vastly different from playing and hunting. Now, while our traditional games train us for hunting and gathering, they don't necessarily train us for the modern world. They fail to train us towards building bridges or building spaceships or farming or navigating different ecosystems that include everything from farms to bridges to economics.
And we have schools for that.
What we have done is we have taken our children, plunked them into classrooms, and we talk at them. And play has been reduced and relegated to arbitrary cat and mouse games that perhaps might have been useful to our ancestors, but just don't teach us more outside of, let's say, physical training or rudimentary social training.
But from an evolutionary point of view, Zain, wouldn't all kinds of learning, whether through play or through puzzle solving or through mimicry of elders and peers, be rewarding by itself?
Well, learning mostly doesn't feel like learning anymore. The best kind of learning happens when a problem is presented to us in multiple contexts and we get multiple opportunities to solve it. The relationship between asked to remember something at school with the premise that it may or may not come in handy decades later is too far removed and low stakes for the learner to be even remotely engaged. The steps of learning don't have any end goal in sight and hence no clarity of application or problem solving or emotional reward at the end of the learning step. To cure the challenge, what we have done so far is introduce an external reward, an extrinsic reward. These range from the pride that comes in showing off your grade or the bribe of getting a treat if you perform well.
So is there a way we can reclaim our gaming brain for pedagogy?
Well, let's try going back to the bridge example. Imagine each step of the complex system that we need to learn to build a bridge turn into an interactive exercise with riddles and puzzles and small steps that you take. And each step along the way through trial and error teaches you complex systems like weight distribution, tension, compression. Each element of this larger science built into a game, end goals are defined and tools are given to us. The game encourages us, the learners, to take risks, to try solutions which are novel, which are new, and slowly arrive at the idea of what the best possible bridge could be. Maybe even look at the best possible bridges after that and optimize them and find solutions that no one has ever thought of.
Wouldn't that mean constantly reinventing the wheel?
Actually, a combination of reinventing the wheel and then being exposed to the best in wheel engineering. So the first step is stating the problem statement very, very clearly. Metaphorically speaking, transportation at speed. Then letting creative play unfold slowly till the learner comes up with the semblance of a wheel, and then exposing the learner to the best solutions that humans already have found in this wheel science.
So again, how do you make learning fun? How do you make learning systems intuitive?
So when we experience the aha moment of having solved a problem, it is our brain rewarding us for having figured something out. Imagine a monkey sitting on a tree. While climbing down, it spots a few dots in the grass and engages with them. It's a riddle it's trying to solve. Soon enough, it solves the problem and realizes that these dots moving together are a leopard. It gets a reward with an aha experience. Natural selection is candy for saving its own life.
A dopamine serotonin reward for an act of survival like eating food or loving your kin.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, we always thought that our body releases dopamine when we do something that is good for us. Actually, it turns out to be very, very peculiar. When we imagine being at the slot machines and where we lose more often than not, and common sense dictates not going back, but we keep going back and we keep trying, we're at one last chance. What's happening here? Imagine yourself pulling that lever on the slot machine. The first wheel stops at 7, the second one stops at 7, and the third one doesn't, but doesn't matter anymore. You've already gotten the hit of dopamine because your brain releases a dopamine high in anticipation of the reward. You don't need to win. You just need to know that you might. What's even more interesting is that dopamine activates our reward centers, which help us stay focused and repeat the same activity again and again. Evolutionarily, fun is the reward for playing and play is our strategy for learning.
Right.
With tools of puzzle solving, micro levels and ladder progressions, peer dynamics like cooperation and competition, the act of learning itself should be filled with micro rewards.
Tell us about how games allow us to create simulations where the relationship between learning something and the application could also be bridged in extremely complex systems especially.
Yeah. First, from the hundreds of variables around us, a game could allow us to limit and isolate the ones that we are currently studying. Experimenting and interacting with these few elements and their interactions between each other can help us get a working grasp of the fundamental principles at play. A game as simple as Monopoly could help us illustrate the relationship between capital and opportunities and the self-perpetuating cycle of debt and ownership. The rich here get richer and the poor get poorer. Games can also compress events that would normally take years and decades into smaller capsules of consumptions of minutes and hours. We can experience things that would otherwise take us multiple lifetimes, and we can engage with the systems, see the reaction of our actions, go back, try something new, and experience the aha moment of solving the problem ourselves. A single session of play can take us through hundreds of possibilities, hundreds of years, and point out the best strategies and teach them to us through trial and error. Games are a translator for making complex systems intuitive. They allow us to compress time and complexity into capsules that are relevant, fun, and consumable.
You mean a game about global warming could show us the intricate relationship between human industry and climate change?
Yeah, maybe this game could allow us to tweak our output, our consumption, and show us the effects long term of our consumption on the ecosystem, on our lifestyles, on our planet, and see what happens over the next 10 years, 20 years, 50 years. As a matter of fact, what I would do is flip the relationship around. A game where the player has to accelerate climate change and exploit all the flaws in the system that lead to climate change. and you will experience the flaws in a very visceral way. The understanding of how our economy and our machine works from this vantage point will, in the real world, train us to keep an eye out for what is going to come back for us in the long run. I call this the antagonist method.
And that's exactly the narrative tool you use in Shasan.
Yeah, exactly. In Shasan, you don't be a politician, you make policies and you win elections. But at the end of the game, you come back into the real world and you realize that you are just that voter peg that you are shuffling around the whole game. So right now, the tools of game design are being used to create habit-forming rituals that bind our attention. And they're being used by everything from online shopping to FPS games. Our education systems are competing with these games and machines for the attention of our children and young adults. We must use and hijack the same tools of engagement to enrich and educate instead of just escapism.
Right, like the metaphor we often use of junk food. We have junk games at the detriment of the player.
Yeah, and the human brain is very vast and our learning isn't monolithic. We can learn in multiple ways, through multiple sources. We can learn through stories, we can learn through art, design, expression, poetry. We compress all this learning together into our personal heuristic model and amplify our genetic code. Gamified learning, gamified pedagogy is just one tool in our closet of cultural dissemination, and it's a very, very powerful tool at that.
So I guess in sharing these insights, we use examples and abstractions. I hope someday we'd be able to gamify these very insights and make the tools of gamified pedagogy even more intuitively accessible for everyone. And I know that you and your team at our studio have been working on that for some time now. And my own fervor in recording this conversation comes from wanting to put your process on a community clock. So I have people's support in nudging you towards making that game soon enough.
Yeah, right now I'm concentrating on shipping Shasan next month, after which the team and I start working on this game and a few other games. The idea is to take the most complex ideas in science, philosophy, policy, and convert them into these interactive, consumable, exciting capsules that we call games.